I was asked by Toshiba, and I thank them for inviting me here to talk about some of the work that we are doing currently at Stony Brook. In cardiac CT, as you all know, this is one of the new kit in the imaging world, and we've been through a lot over the last 6-7 years, and I think finally we see the light of day. And I think this particular application of cardiac CT, you're going to see a tremendous growth in the next few years. This is my obligatory disclosure slide. Well, this article in the New England Journal of Medicine a few months ago certainly really shook the world, particularly the reimbursement and the health insurance company. They look at this so-called gold standard for diagnosis of coronary artery disease, the coronary angiography, as the gold standard for everything else to compare with. But when you look at this article, it becomes something of major concern to the healthcare providers. If you look at the NCDR registry and look at all the patients who had diagnostic cath, you see something really alarming. Only a very small percentage, less than half the patient, had obstructive coronary disease. Majority of the patient had either no coronary disease or non-obstructive coronary disease. So why this is the gold standard and what really leading to X-ray angiography as the gold standard? Well, it's because of the test before the angiography, which is the stress test, a test that we sort of love to hate as a cardiologist. I order it all the time. And most of the time, I get a feeling that if I take out a coin and flip it, I probably get a better odd. And this New England Journal of Medicine article attested to that. And the false positive rate of positive stress tests is 60%. Well, that costs money, right? If you get a false positive, you end up going down the path of angiography, and the patient then get a normal cath. You sort of have the good news, bad news scenarios that, well, good news, you don't have anything needed into further intervention. The bad news, you almost die in the cath lab. But what worries me as a clinician is the false negative rate of negative stress tests is alarmingly high, 28%. This is almost unacceptable. And as a clinician, we worry more about false negative than false positive, because this potentially can raise a lot of legal ramifications. So, what is the role of CT? Is this a revolutionary imaging test? Based on the New England Journal of Medicine article, we know that stress test is not that good, and X-ray angiography really does not lead to a lot of diagnostic accuracy in the way that, you know, a lot of the X-ray angiography really are necessary. Can we do something better? And CT sort of fit that very unique role. And what are the facts? Well, the facts are quite clear. And I think this is really without a doubt, I can say it at this moment, after years of fighting with CMS to get CT to category 1 CPT code, which we finally achieved in January of this year. This is a tremendous achievement for a technology that young. As you know, a lot of things that we do in medicine never reach category 1 code or status. And CT got there in such a short period of time, really testimony to many of the investigators who are sitting here and who helped to get the technology and publish the data so that the CMS recognized that this is indeed a proven technology for ruling out heart disease with 99% accuracy. You really can't do much better than that. If you do better than 99%, you might as well be the gold standard. And basically, it's this published literature adopted by the scientific community, and which really influenced the decision-making group in the CMS. This is a meta-analysis, which is published in 2006. There's a more recent one focusing only on the 64 slides, showing the specificity approaching perfection of 99%. A few years ago, the specificity already is quite high. There's nothing come even close to this. Three randomized control study published in the same year, saying the same thing, that 64 slice CT is the most accurate test to rule out the presence of coronary artery disease. Does not matter whether you're looking at disease prevalence that's low, like 14%, or high as 68%. The negative predictive value is extremely high. So pretty much you can be rest assured if you have a negative CTA, pretty much you do not have to worry about having significant obstructive coronary artery disease. Well, that sort of lead to the appropriateness criteria that as a clinician we sort of follow over the last few years, that when we published this in 2006, we didn't have a lot of the randomized control study. But at that time, we already see that CT is really one of the best tests for ruling out symptomatic chest pain, whether it's stable or acute chest pain. In addition to some of the indication that I really don't think you need a lot of randomized control study to prove that CTA is the better option, such as anomalous coronary arteries. And in patients with new onset heart failure, indeed, we have published literature to support this after the appropriateness criteria was published. So we now pretty much use CT as a test for patients with symptoms, particularly after equivocal stress tests or those patients who presented to the emergency room. And tonight I'm going to focus on this particular indication. Well, the CT STAT study that was published, well, not published yet, but the result was presented at the American Heart Association 2009 scientific session, basically support the small study that my friend Gil Raff published a couple of years ago in JACC, saying that CT is at least as good as the standard of care, which is the nuclear stress test. And in fact, in his small study, which later supported by this largest multicenter trial, that CCTA strategy is associated with significantly shorter time to diagnosis. This is very important, particularly for those emergency room doctors and hospital administrators. They are very interested in this. Right now, we are in a situation that we have to turn the bed over very quickly in order to make a profit. Not lose money, let's put it that way. And if you can turn the bed quickly, that means you can at least get the patient out and you can see more patients. And this is very important to many hospital administrators. And CT definitely fit that particular role. And I don't know any hospital to date that are doing nuclear stress tests on a regular basis 7 days a week, maybe one or two in the country. Most hospitals don't do overnight stress tests. So the waiting time for stress tests is often quite long. And in a clinical trial setting, okay, that is you have a research coordinator who is looking after the patient, is 7 hours. And if you use CT, it's much shorter. And certainly in terms of the cost reduction, CT is significantly less compared to the standard of care or standard strategy myocardial perfusion imaging using nuclear stress testing. So this is the randomized control study which show that CT should probably be the test of choice for the emergency room. That particular trial did not specifically look at the complete evaluation of acute chest pain. As you all know, it's quite complicated. When someone come in with chest pain, with hand on the chest, there's so many things can go wrong. And as a clinician, you think of the heart as the most important, but there's other organs that could be involved. And that's why making it very, very tricky as an ER physician when faced with a patient with acute chest pain. Many of the patients with chest pain have risk factor for coronary artery disease, but no clear evidence of acute ischemia. But that doesn't mean that you can ignore coronary artery disease. Some patients have symptoms that often suggest the possibility of pulmonary embolism and aortic dissection as well, such as shortness of breath and sharp pain penetrating to the back, which easily lead to the three lethal causes of chest pain, which now well known as the triple rule out protocol. And that is being done in many hospitals that are using CT as a way to evaluate patients with acute chest pain. And to many emergency room physicians, the key advantage of CT is that we can stop guessing and just see whether the patient has active disease or no disease. Well, you may say that they are not using the brain to think about the differential diagnosis, but I can tell you, I used to work as an emergency room as a physician for many years. It's easy for you to second guess. When you are there on the line of fire, you want to know for sure that the patient you're sending home is not having acute dissection or pulmonary embolism. And this brings up the next point. What is the major difference between research and clinical medicine? Well, for research, sensitivity of 99%, which is CT, with 1% false negative is near perfect test. From a research standpoint, this is about as good as you get, right? But as a clinician, I can tell you 1% false negative is not acceptable. In an emergency room, in a busy emergency room, when you see over 100 patients a week, if you make one mistake every 100 patients, I think you'll spend a lot of time giving depositions. So that's why the emergency physician have a totally different problem they have to face with, and I could understand that. And that's why they want the most accurate test possible, and this is the strategy that many hospitals, including Stony Brook University Medical Center, are using right now, which is when you have chest pain, either you categorize the patient into known or suspected coronary artery disease, then you draw blood tests and do an EKG based on the result. Either the patient go to get admitted, or they go get CTA, or they get stress evaluation for those patients with known coronary artery disease. So this is based on pretty much that the CT-STAT trial algorithm. Well, this is the data that we gathered over the last year at Stony Brook. Before I came to Stony Brook, they hardly do any CT. And in the first year, we did 511 CTA for acute chest pain. And all patients had negative initial EKG and troponin. Now, this doesn't include those patients that really no reason to suspect coronary artery disease, right? Young 20-year-old came in hysterical with chest pain. You're not going to even do an EKG sometimes or enzyme because you know that patient is so low risk that really no reason to even suspect coronary artery disease. I'm talking about those patients that you have genuine suspicions that the patient had coronary disease, you do enzyme and EKG, and those patients, we evaluate them with CT. And what we found is that a lot of the patient had really normal coronary and can be discharged home almost immediately after the CTA. And we followed the outcome on all these patients over the period of time since the discharge from the emergency room, looking specifically at the downstream events occur, such as PCI, MI, and death. And this is the standard approach that many a group are using, basically either normal, non-obstructive, that is less than 50% stenosis, or obstructive, greater than 50% stenosis. And the patient population that we faced the first year, mostly pretty low-risk patient, I have to say. The mean age was 48.6, 51% female, and this is the breakdown of the coronary risk factor. What we found was that 71% of the patient who has CCTA in our first year had normal coronary, basically zero calcium score, nothing on the CTA. 24% had non-obstructive coronary disease, and only 5% are obstructive. And the mean age, as you get older, obviously the group get more likely of getting obstructive coronary disease. And the admission rate by CCTA was 80% if you had obstructive coronary disease. And if you're non-obstructive or normal, basically you can be sent home. And very importantly, we follow these patients over a 6 months period. None of the patients with normal or non-obstructive CCTA had a subsequent MI, PCI, or CABG or death. Basically, you had a zero adverse outcome if you had a negative CCTA or non-obstructive CCTA. Well, that is with the 64-slice CT, which is the standard of care. And this is one that most hospitals currently are still using for the evaluation of coronary artery disease. And it still takes 6 to 12 seconds to acquire the entire heart image. And depending on the model that you get of vendors, you get different misregistration or banding artifact. And this is, to me, the major problem with the 64-slice scanner. And I can tell you, oftentimes, this could be very, very tricky to interpret. And even using the prospective approach, which is what is recommended now for most patients who has heart rate that is below 70s, you're trying to save the radiation dose and do it prospectively, but you often get this misalignment or misregistration artifact that make it very difficult to be 100% sure that the patient does not have obstructive coronary disease. And this lead to my Murphy's Law of performing cardiac CTA for the emergency room. This is from my 2 years experience. No matter how well you beta block and coach the ED patient, arrhythmia will occur right before you're about to scan. Okay. In addition, the ED patient with chest pain in general cannot hold still for more than a few seconds. I don't know why. I mean, maybe it's a bed bug or something. They just somehow, they just have to move around, and you know how hard you're trying to convince them that just stay still for a few seconds, only a few seconds, and you can have some artifact like this. I mean, this looked like someone's having an active seizure. You know, in that few seconds, you can move so many times. I don't know how you do this. And this is not unusual. We see this all the time. And rhythm problem and causing and you to have to do retrospectively, then your radiation dose go up. Because if you don't do retrospectively, you won't get the systolic phase, which may contain the image that give you the answer. And this will lead to some other very important point that I'm going to bring up later. A very subtle motion artifact can make a study almost impossible to clear, like a case like this. And all you have to do is just look at the retrospective data, you see that this is a motion artifact. But this is very, very subtle. Well, blurry image could lead to wrong diagnosis. And depending on where you sit, this could be Marilyn Monroe or Albert Einstein. And in many ways, CT is the same thing. Depending on how you look at it, which phase you look at it, could be obstructive or non-obstructive. And now the push for lower radiation dose add more pressure on all of us who are trying to do a good study. And this is published in JAMA, which show that the median dose is 12 millisievert for cardiac CCTA, and which all trying to lower it as much as possible. And depending on the expertise of the operator, you can do it with significantly lower dose or higher dose. And training and education seems to be the most important factor in this. And for the emergency room, this is even harder because the patient is not like the regular patient that you see in the office who walk in with a suit and tie and took the beta blocker, calm and collected. Emergency room patients are notorious. They're just very anxious. So what can make the ED CT a little easier? Well, I can tell you, my experience on the 320 is really eye-opening. And I've been through the generation of from 4 detectors, 16, 64, 128, now 320. So you're thinking that, well, the bigger the coverage should be better. But how much better? And I used to be in the camp that speed is more important. The faster that you can capture the moving target, the shutter speed should give you better image. Well, now I actually have a second thought about this particular rationale. With the volume scanner, all you need is single revolution, and the table doesn't move, and you get the entire heart. That actually is very, very useful. And I'll tell you why. When you have a case like this, and you see a little lesion here, as you all know, a seasoned CT expert would ignore the white stuff and focus on the not so white area, because the soft plaque or non-calcified plaque usually is the area that you can be certain. The calcified area, you cannot really be sure because of the blooming and the beam hardening artifacts. So in a case like this, in the past, I would not be able to say for sure that this is a real lesion, because I always have to think about, well, could this be a misregistration? In fact, on the test, I would immediately say that this is misregistration until proven otherwise. But in the volume scanner era, there is no such thing as misregistration. So I actually have to change my entire reading habit. And when I see something like this on a volume scanner, you can be rest assured that this is a real lesion. Okay. So what is the value of a non-diagnostic super low dose CCTA scan? Nothing, because the patient is going to need additional tests if the test is not diagnostic. So what happened from a CT technologist standpoint? Their main concern is not able to give you useful data. So from my own experience, most of the time, when in doubt, the technologist will scan the patient retrospectively. Okay, if you don't believe it, you go back and talk to your technician. Unless they're just trying to screw you, they will do prospective and have you sort through the image yourself. But most of the time, the conscientious technologists that I work with, they are really trying to make my life easy, but they add more dose to the patient's scan. And so that's why it's important to have a machine or a scanner that has some built-in artificial intelligence that will help the technician to acquire good data. And this is something that I find the volume scanner very, very useful. And in addition to the standard prospective mode that you're all very familiar with, it has a way to even go faster in case that you have to cover a wide volume. Let's say you want to do a triple rule out. The volume scanner is not going to be able to cover the entire chest, so you're going to have to move at least a little bit. Then there are ways to shorten the time the table moves so that you can even lower the dose and lower the amount of contrast. And you have your usual ECG with modulation that you want to scan the patient that you need functional data. And for those patients with heart rate all over the place, you're going to still use what we call the retrospective scan, basically scan continuously, and hopefully you'll get some useful information in that large volume of data. So this is the highest dose. And you want the machine to be able to help you to think, rather than you have to be there all the time to tell the tech which mode to use. Because if you're not there, I can tell you the tech can use retrospective. And I'll show you some of the data that we have. And using prospective CTA in our laboratory, since we've been using the volume scanner, almost majority, I would say 95% of the patient was scanned prospectively, because the machine is able to decide what kind of prospective to use and adjust according to the heart rate. And that is very important because most technology does not want to make mistakes. And this algorithm, very unique, will allow the machine and the, take the guessing of the technologies in terms of how wide and how much they need to pad the image. So this is another very useful algorithm built in that, you know, in the past, before I used this, I didn't know that this is possible. As I was saying in my Murphy's laws, the atopic beat going to happen at the time you scan. And when you see it, there's nothing you could do prior to the volume scanner. But now, with the volume scanner, we actually have a way of suppressing the scanning mode and wait for the next normal heartbeat to scan. That's very useful because I can tell you most of the time, I don't know why, either the contrast or something, when they hit the patient, the PVC occur. And there's nothing you could stop prior to the real-time beat control, which is very, very useful in the new generation of scanner. And for patients who suddenly the heart rate speed up because of the anxiety or the contrast effect, you have multi-segment scan that can automatically turn on without your interactions. And the machine know exactly, based on the last 5 heartbeat before the machine start to scan, it will decide that this is not going to be a scan that you can do prospective using one single revolution. It will automatically go to 2-segment mode. Now, obviously, the trade-off is radiation, but you save the scan. And that is very important. You don't want to be there and look at it and say, geez, there's nothing I could do. Well, now the machine will help you to avoid those kind of situations. And for those patients that you need to do triple rule out, and even with the volume scanner, 16 centimeter coverage, you're not going to be able to cover the entire chest. Well, this machine will allow you to scan this and using prospective trigger or the target Y volume, which does not use the arrhythmia detection, and you can get this type of image time and time again. And this is really one of the most difficult scan if you ask the radiology technologists to do triple rule out and time again make sure the contrast fill the aorta, the lung, and the coronary at the same opacification. Very, very challenging. Well, now we've been hitting it almost 100% every time, no matter what heart rate. If the heart rate is slow, you use the target Y volume, you save the dose. If the heart rate is fast, you use prospective, and it's still low dose. You don't have to use retrospective. That's very important. And this is from my own collections, and using the target Y volume, we're able to scan this and able to get the top and the bottom and equal opacification of all 3 major compartments and get a diagnostic test with a super low radiation dose of 4 millisievert. For those patients that you need function, well, there's nothing much you can do. You need to cover systole and diastole, and for those patients you need to look at valvular function, you have to use the modulation mode, and this is something that is built in. So, and the real-time exposure control is another unique feature that actually you don't have to think about what padding. It's depending on the heartbeat. Depending on the last 5 heartbeat prior to the scan, the machine will decide what the proper exposure time is. You don't have to put in 25% padding or 50% padding. Everything are done automatically so that you can do the studies. The technology is actually now so in love with this scanner that you can't even get them back to the 64 slice scanner because it's so easy. And the study time and time again, just I always make the analogy of Chinese rice cooker. You know, every bowl of rice looks the same. You know, that's what you want to do in the emergency room. You don't want every time look different. And this is our experience on the 64 slice versus the 320, the first month that we used the machine, look at the number. In 2009, the entire year, we did about 500-something study. Well, now, 1 month, we do about 240-something study. Okay, so you see the volume have gone up tremendously, and we're able to randomize patient to the two different machine. Well, actually, three different machine. We have 264 and 1320. And if you look at this data, it's very interesting. And I just want to bring your attention to the prospective mode, which is the low-dose mode, right? If you use the 64 slice, if you ask the tech to do it on the 64 slice, majority of the patient will be scanned with retrospective mode. On the 320, majority of the patient will scan with the prospective mode. Okay, I think that really speaks for itself, that if you want to do a low-dose scan, give a machine that will help the technologists to get a good study each and every time without worrying about some kind of freaky event occur, or the patient move, or the irregular rhythm that really drive them nuts. So this is a case to highlight another new feature about the volume scanner. This is not an unusual patient, I'm sure that you all have seen. 88-year-old with chest pain, elevated D-dimer, non-specific ECG, initial troponin I was negative. Heart rate was a little fast, blood pressure was borderline low, and they wanted to do a CTA of the chest to rule out PE, okay, and dissection. They said it's unlikely that you're going to get any useful information for the coronary, but just give me the information about the PA and the AO should be enough. Well, we say, well, let's see if we can give you all three compartments. And we did it with a gated on a 320 using the using the prospective trigger mode. And we were able to rule out acute pulmonary embolism, aortic dissections. And we just give a try for the coronary. With a heart rate of 95, well, we were able to see the coronary quite well. And if you look at the dose, it's significantly less than what we normally use on the 64 slice. 18 millisievert typically for a triple rule out. On the 320, typical millisievert is about less than 6. And the scan time is also significantly less for obvious reason. And more importantly, the amount of contrast. In the elderly, you don't want to give too much contrast. This is the machine to go. 60 cc, that's all it takes. Well, this is the case that we saw two lesions. Okay, this is a heart rate of 95. Obviously, this is done with multi-segmentation, not a single volume. And you can see the two lesions clearly. Now the question is, which is the culprit? You see two lesions in a lady who had positive D-dimer, which was false positive, no dissection. You know that the reason for the chest pain, shortness of breath, is coronary artery disease. Well, you can do a nuclear perfusion, okay, which is another, maybe 10, 12 millisievert, or look at your data that you just obtained from the triple rule out. You may see perfusion defect, and this is without any stress agent, okay? Just a coronary study. She didn't get nitro because of the borderline hypotension, and we were able to identify the perfusion defect to the LAD territory, okay? And she was later cath, and indeed, the LAD was the culprit lesion. So now, I think we have a quadruple rule out, okay? In addition to the standard three that practically all 64 slice can do, now we can do perfusion without any special preparation. Just use the data that you just get and you can look for perfusion defect and believable perfusion defect. I'm sure that you can do it on 64 slice, but then depending on when the contrast arrive, I can tell you there are believable and there are unbelievable perfusion defect. And this is what I call believable perfusion defect, and you can see the in cath indeed the high grade stenosis in the mid LAD. So, what else can you do with this perfusion? Well, we were asked to look at a patient who has ventricular tachycardia. They're looking for any type of ARVD, okay, as a cause of the ventricular tachycardia. Well, this patient has very unique fatty infiltration, not infiltrating the right ventricle, but infiltrating the left ventricle. Okay, this is not the usual pattern of ischemic heart disease, as you all know. Ischemic heart disease tends to go from endocardial to epicardial. This is from epi to endo, more along the line of the arrhythmogenic right ventricle, except it affects the left. Well, so what is the similarity and difference between the perfusion that we do with MR that we do every day, right? And with the CT perfusion. Well, if you look at the contrast kinetic, this is published by Gerber a few years ago, you would say that they should be the same. So you can do the same thing like what you do in MR perfusion with CT using iodine-based contrast, because the perfusion curve through myocardium and infarct zone basically are identical. Well, if you look at MR perfusion, this is from our laboratory, you can see that it's a dynamic study. And you just basically acquire data and then look for the perfusion defect. Well, this is only doable if the imaging modality doesn't cause harm and doesn't cause radiation to the human body. So MR, obviously, you can sit there and watch this. You can't do this with CT. So CT perfusion, even though the pharmacokinetic of the contrast agent is very similar to MR, but you can't do the same thing that you do with MR because you only have one chance to get the image. So you have to do it at the perfect time, and that is a major challenge. And make sure that you can do it time and time again with the same contrast arrival and the scanning parameters. And this patient on the MR has a tight RCA lesion, subsequently was stented, and also has some delay hyperenhancement. I think this particular application of MR is going to be belong to MR for quite some time, because you know, a lot of work being done on CT, I still think that MR is so good and so robust and so reproducible that I think it will be the gold standard for years to come. Well, I mean, basically what MR, what I show you in MR is like the brain dynamic imaging, and which you can do with volume scan very well. And this is one of the major applications of the volume scanner, because you don't need to move the table, so you just keep taking picture. You can see the flow in, flow out of the contrast, of the iodine contrast. Well, how you can do it with CT is not going to be the same. And this is the major challenge, and that's why I think in the future, you will need a volume scanner in order to do myocardial perfusion and do it in such a way that is believable and reproducible. The standard approach is to get a calcium score to help you to localize the region that you need to scan. Then you do a stress and rest perfusion, depending on which book you read or which group that you believe in. I personally believe in doing stress CT first, followed by rest. I know that the core 320 group believe in doing rest first, followed by stress. This is just, you know, I just think that the stress part should be done first before any contrast get into the myocardium. But that's just my own preference. And as you can see, you have to do it in such a way that the scan are almost identical. And this is the most challenging part with doing cardiac CT. You know, trying to do two studies on the same patient on the same day and get the same image is not that easy. Okay? You don't believe it, you can try it. So it's almost like a William Tell's apple. You know, when you do cardiac stress rest perfusion, that is, you need to get identical contrast arrival time, both times, stress and rest, identical scanning parameters, the KV and MA, so that the two images look comparable. And also, the location of the heart has to be at the same place twice, because otherwise, you're really comparing apple with orange. So that's almost like this arrow, boom, it hit the apple. Not this one, that hit the head. So that would kill the guys. So that's not good. You can't compare. So, and that's the challenge. So when you able to do this, and I think with the volume scanner is much more doable, because anytime when you have to move the table or move the anything, or the contrast arrival and the table movement are not synchronized, you're not going to be able to get reproducible and believable perfusion defect. And this is a patient that we did adenosine stress perfusion and rest perfusion, 9.8 millisievert with this triple rule out stress rest perfusion altogether, including actually we threw in a delay hyperenhancement, only 9.8 millisievert. And you can see a clear perfusion defect in the stress image, but not in the rest image. I mean, the study has to be done identical. Otherwise, you can't compare. I mean, if this arrived early, this arrived late, forget it. All bets are off. If you look at the MR data, you could understand why that's the case. And we did it with 10 minutes post-adenosine perfusion. And what about those cases where the calcium is so large that you cannot be sure that there's no obstructive lesion? Now we throw in an adenosine stress perfusion, and we can clear the patient pretty much every time. And if you just do a single volume, the dose obviously is a lot less, 6.2 millisievert. What to do with this case? Well, this is not a case that you see every day, but just interesting. We did it recently. A man who came from a foreign country with this abnormal coronary anomaly, which is basically a coronary fistula that go from left main to the SVC. And he's symptomatic. So the question is this coronary steel that's causing the symptoms, or is this a high output failure symptoms, right, because of this large shunt? Well, you can rule out one of them by doing a functional imaging using a volume scanner, doing adenosine stress rest perfusion. We show that there is no perfusion defect that pretty much ruled out the possibility of steel phenomenon. And we actually later did a MR phase contrast, showed that he had a 4-to-1 shunt. So the coronary fistula has a very high shunt and causing high output failure that need to be intervened. So this is, again, a very important question, give you a lot of information about the pathologies, about the coronary. He has some coronary plaque, but non-obstructive. Basically, he does not need a diagnostic cath. And we also have perfusion imaging to help us to understand the physiology of this AV fistula. So I think the volume CT scanner really opened up a whole new arena, or a whole new world of cardiac imaging. And from an emergency room standpoint, I see firsthand the facilitation of the performance of cardiac CT. The technologists love to use the scanner. In fact, it's hard to ask them to go back to the 64 slice, only because we have a research protocol require them to randomize patient, though they have to go back. Otherwise, they will only scan the patient on 320, because it's much easier to perform a good study time and time again. It saves radiation dose to the patient, at least 50% less than study done on the 64 slice. The contrast volume also significantly reduced, okay, at least 30 to 40 cc less. When you add up all the study you do, that's not an insignificant amount of money saved. It allows evaluation of resting and rest perfusion, which I think really is a killer application for this particular scanner. And really ultimate one-stop shop imaging device for cardiovascular medicine. With that, I'll stop here. Thank you very much.